Welcome to Valley Grove Baptist Church, located at 1731 South, U.S. Highway 281 in Stephenville, Texas. We are glad you joined us for our 10:30 Sunday morning worship service. If you'd like to learn more about Valley Grove, please check us out at our website at valleygrove.net. Now, join us for the morning worship service already in progress.
Cleansing blood of the Lamb. hold on to it, and after the service, meet Brother Jeremy in the back. He's got a gift for you, just a way of saying thank you for coming and worshiping with us. So we are certainly glad that you are here today. Have any of you attended Sunday school this morning in our start of new curriculum that we're doing for 6 weeks? There you go. Great study. We're going to continue that thought even in the sermon time. It's on discipleship. Now, if you missed out, plan next Sunday to come and jump into Sunday school class. Just great study of discipleship and what God has intended for us. We have to oftentimes ask ourselves a question, reminding ourselves of what discipleship entails. One of the things we ask is, have we said a good word about Jesus to someone this week? In other words, has Jesus been a part of our conversation? Have we invited someone to come and worship and study God's word with us? Have we seen a need and met that need in the name of Christ? And have we spent time in His word, letting His word wash over us? We have a job to do as His disciples. Amen? Amen. And it is a beautiful and powerful job. Hey, let's stay and do one other thing as disciples. Let's greet one another in the love of Christ. Glad you're here, Tom.
Good at that. I'm pretty committed, but I'm not very disciplined.
I will follow. So I could walk. today, that we can trust in you. Lord, you are a firm foundation. And God, we can trust you for salvation today. We can trust you to be a follower and committed to you, Father, to leave all the things of this world behind and pursue you, Father, with all that we have. And God, I just pray that through this study, God, that you reveal to us things that maybe we're holding on to, maybe things that we're putting our trust and faith in. And God, for those of us who fear those things, fear relinquishing you of those things, God, I pray that we will see that you're faithful. God, that you're good and that we can trust you. We can depend upon you to be our strength, to be our provider. And God, I just pray that you'll speak to us through this study so that you can have all of us, not just some part. You can have every inch, every part of our being today. God, for the one today who does not know you as Lord and Savior, I pray, God, that today would be the day of salvation. God, I pray that you bless this offering. I pray that you bless the gift and the giver. God, may your name be lifted up and glorified in this service. We love you, Lord, and may you pray. Amen. You may be seated. Do you want to dismiss our boys and girls to children's church? Right back to this place. Stand. Do you want to dismiss the children's church?
The love of God won't let me stay the same.
children, chaperone several proms and other gatherings like that. I remember the 8th grade prom with Tate. We were chaperoning. We didn't get out there and dance with the students, but off on the side, she and I began to jitterbug to one of the songs. I think that was too flamboyant or anything, but here in just a couple of minutes, we could just feel her presence. I didn't see him at the time, but you could feel something. And it was Tate standing there, disapproving at every move and turn and everything there was. So like scolding children, we stopped. Every child, I believe, has those moments, those seasons in dealing with their parents. Some are short, some longer. But they have those seasons when their parents are no longer cool, or hip, or fly. I still don't know what fly means. That's like a saying, so my kids roll their eyes. But if you look, there's a cycle in the way that kids and parents, or the way that kids view parents. In those early years, especially in the infancy and in their young childhood, we're the greatest. They clutch to mom's leg. They don't want them out of their sights. I mean, mom and dad are the greatest. Then there's this period where we transition from being the greatest into being good. They still love us and like us around. They're getting a little more independence. As we get into those preteen years, we go from good to useful. They'll need us, they want us to provide, and those kind of things. The truth is, there's this period of teenage years, and some short, some long, where we go from useful to just plain dumb. Nothing we say makes sense, they disagree with everything. Like I said, it may last a long time or a little while, but eventually they will grow out of that as they get towards college and everything, and we become useful again because they want to go to college. As they get into young adulthood, we go from useful to good. They have a few more questions. Our advice all of a sudden becomes relevant a little bit more. I'm told that when we get to grandparent stage, we become the greatest again. I'm looking forward to that full cycle. Family dynamics and the cycles of it, those things are real and they're happening. They're important. Scripture speaks to their importance a great deal. Today, Jesus speaks about family dynamics in just a little different way. Some might even say in a harsh way. We want to see what is it that Jesus is trying to tell us and teach us today. So as we begin, let's pray and then we'll dive in. Gracious Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. We pray, Father, that you will teach us today. We pray that you will give us understanding by the power of your Holy Spirit, Father. Let your truth be planted deep within our hearts. We pray, Father, that your will be done in our lives. We pray that our discipleship to you will be pleasing. And so, Father, in this time, let your Spirit reign in this place and in our hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our base scripture this morning is in Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, we're going to begin at verse 34 and look at verses 34 through 39. So take your Bibles and turn there with me this morning. Matthew chapter 10. Did I really say Hebrews? One of them. We're not going to use Hebrews. Matthew chapter 10. Verses 34 through 39. That's what we're going to learn. So with that passage, just want to follow along with me as I read. Jesus' words teaching his disciples says this: Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be members of his own household. Anyone who loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. For whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Well, let's understand a little bit of the background and the context. great deal that the scripture speaks about of the family. So let's understand a little bit of those dynamics. First of all, we know that family is extremely important to God. One of the Ten Commandments, honor your father and mother, right? And so God places a great deal of emphasis on honoring father and mother and caring for the family. Jesus said that if one doesn't care for his own family, better than a millstone tied around his neck and cast into the sea. I mean, there's this understanding of the importance of the family in the Jewish life in biblical times and continuing certainly on in the truth of today. Jesus used family dynamics oftentimes in parables. Many of the wedding parables, the parable of the wedding feast, but also the parable of the ten virgins, the bridesmaids, if you will, has a setting of the family in around the wedding. It was a tradition in that day that the father of the groom and father of the bride, they would meet and negotiate the arrangement for the marriage. And then they would separate and go back to their homes. And the son then would begin to prepare a place, a room that would be attached onto the father's house, okay? And whenever the father of the groom determined that room was ready to support his new bride, then the father would give the okay, the trumpets would be sounded, and the parade would start, and they would go and they would gather up the bride, and then would go have a wedding. Okay, that's the way it worked. Now listen to this in some of the parables. When you have the parables of the ten virgins or the ten bridesmaids, what they're doing is they are waiting to hear the trumpet sound. They are waiting there for the wedding to begin. And five run out of oil, they go to get more oil. They were not ready for the trumpets, and when the trumpets were sounded, they weren't there. Okay, that's the setting in which that parable is told. Think of John 14. Jesus in the last days telling his disciples, don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it weren't so, I would have told you. But I go there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, then I will come and receive you, that you may be where I am also. What is the picture? Jesus said, my Father's house are many rooms. I'm going to go prepare a room for you. And my Father says that it's time, the rooms are prepared, and it's ready. I'm going to sound the trumpets. I'm going to meet you. So we understand the importance of family to Jesus. It's all throughout Scripture. So what is he saying here in these verses when he's talking about hatred towards children or towards parents? Is this just a turnaround from what Jesus is teaching in other places? No, what Jesus is doing is taking this very strong language to get his point across to the people and saying, listen, you know how much I love family. You know how important family is to God. Now hear me closely when I say this, is if, even if your family is of a greater priority than God, then you've got another one. You got another one. There is no relationship to be had, whether it's your relationship with father or mother, or whether it's your relationship with children, there is no relationship to be had that should be priority over your relationship with God. And he says it in strong words. Because he wants to get the point across. Are we supposed to love our mother and father? Absolutely. Are we supposed to love our sons and daughters? Absolutely. In fact, Scripture teaches us that in big, powerful, beautiful ways. But never let us think that those relationships are to take priority of our relationship with God and Jesus Christ. Amen? And so Jesus makes that point of being committed to him. All in, fully and completely, makes it in a very powerful way. It's not a statement about hating family. It's a statement about the commitment and surrender and focus that we are to have in being disciples of Christ. And those are three things I want to look at real quickly this morning. First of all is this, a disciple of Jesus is committed. A disciple of Jesus is committed. In the Sunday school lesson this morning, it says, a disciple's priorities reflect undivided loyalty and love for Christ. Undivided loyalty and love for Christ. In other words, Jesus is not an add-on. When I was working at the bank, I had a salesman come by pretty regularly. He came by one day, and he was oh so proud. He just got him a new pickup, a big old four-door Ford, and I mean, it was leathered out and just as nice as could be. He said, oh man, it drives so well. I was like, man, the gas mileage has just got to be awful on him. He goes, oh no. No, I found this chip, this computer chip, that I could put in there on top of the module, and it would like increase the gas mileage like 40%. And he goes, so now I drive it all over the place. It's great. great. He has his dream truck now with good gas mileage. I mean, that's great. Sometimes we want to treat Jesus like that. Hey, Jesus, life going pretty good. It's doing all right. You know, it's got a few bumps in it. Well, I'm going to sprinkle you. I'm going to add you on. I'm going to plug you in. And you're going to make my life better. Scripture says Jesus makes our life new. Old gone, new here. Jesus isn't an add-on that we plug in to make life better. Jesus is totally new. We die to our old way of life. We're raised up to new life in Christ. He's not an add-on. Jesus isn't a seasoning. He's the main course. I know it's not dinner time yet, but you're already hungry. But listen to me, okay? He's not a seasoning. Have you heard the story of the chicken and pig walking around the yard and they smell breakfast being cooked one morning? Chicken kind of puffs the chest out and goes, man, breakfast couldn't happen without me. You smell those eggs? Those smell delicious. I am the king of breakfast. Pig looks at the chicken and goes, stick your chest back in a little bit. They couldn't have breakfast without me. You may be involved in breakfast. I was committed. The pig was committed. You understand what I'm saying? Chicken may be involved in delivering the egg. The ham and the bacon, it doesn't happen without the pig being fully committed, right? There's no turning back. He can't change his mind and go backwards, right? It's done. Well, in the life of faith, we're called to be pigs. We're called to be committed. We're not called to be chickens that are involved in the breakfast process. We're not called to be disciples that are involved in the faith process. We're called to be pigs, fully committed, no turning back, burn the boats, I'm all in, pigs for the sake of Christ. Greg Laurie in the book for today's lesson says it this way, if you really want to be my disciples, he's paraphrasing the words of Christ, if you really want to be my disciple, you must love me more than anyone or anything else. A disciple of Jesus is committed. A disciple of Jesus is also surrendered. Surrendered. The lesson said it this way. A disciple surrenders complete control of his or her life to Christ. Surrenders complete control of his or her life to Christ. Jim and I have been watching stories or shows on the monarchies of France and England and others. One of the documentaries about Henry VIII. He is called for one of his servants or his lords to come see. Now, this guy is on his deathbed, literally on his deathbed. And he gets word, the king has called for you to come see him. And he goes and begins to get out of bed. They're like, what are you doing? You can't go. You're sick. You got to stay in bed. I mean, you're dying. He said, when the king calls, you go. And he had people carry him there to see the king. Oh, that we would have that understanding of our faith in Jesus Christ. That when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords calls, we go. Because the disciple of Jesus is surrendered fully and completely. Too often in our churches today, the picture of Jesus that we present is that of a benevolent, tender, meek teacher that would never demand anything of anyone. But gently let each one find their way through life. But while Jesus is most certainly benevolent, kind, and tender, and meek, we must never think that he does not demand fierce loyalty and surrender. He is not satisfied with followers serving two masters. He demands that we follow him singly and solely, because we must be surrendered to him fully and completely. Disciple of Christ is committed. A disciple of Christ is surrendered. Thomas Jefferson, the third president of the United States, is probably known well for his Bible. Now, at first glance, that sounds like a good thing. But honestly, the Jefferson Bible is famous for other reasons. In fact, Jefferson is famous for taking verses and passages and even chapters of his Bible that he disagreed with or didn't like and cutting them out. Literally cutting the verses and the passages out from his Bible. That's not what we're called to do. We're called to surrender. And when the King of Kings calls on us, we are to go and we are to do. A disciple is committed, the disciple is surrendered, and finally the disciple of Jesus is focused. Blessed says the disciple navigates life by clinging to what is eternal. Clinging to what is eternal. That word cling's not bad. It's a good word. But it reminds me of dryer sheets, right? I mean, dryer sheets cling to the, you know, pants leg or the inside of your sleeve. Have you ever been going throughout the day and all of a sudden the dryer sheet's kind of working its way out of the sleeve or just as you went down? Like, dryer sheets cling. I like the word cleave better. A similar meaning, but cleave has some hooks in it. It's got some meat to it. We're called to cleave to our spouse. We cleave and there's hooks in there. We're not going anywhere. A good friend of mine, Stan Tucker, he defined cleave this way. And we're going to go back to the laundry room, okay? Not the dryer. We're going to go to the washing machine this time. He said, if you want to know what cleave is, he says, take your cap, put it in your hand, washing machine on spin cycle, open the lid. It has to be open. We can't do it these days. It goes off. Hold the cap over the washing machine on spin cycle. The cap will cleave to your hand and to your arm. You will know where your arm stops and the cap starts. But it's all one. Cleave. That's how we are called to be. To cleave to things that are eternal. To cleave to Christ. To cleave to His truth. Cleave to His ways of life. A disciple cleaves to Christ. But we don't know where one stops and the other starts. We become one with Christ. Jenna said it was described to her this way, that we put up the Philippians 4:8 gate. The 4:8 gate, so that nothing comes in unless it goes through the 4:8 gate. Turn with me to Philippians 4. You'll see what we mean. Philippians 4:8. The 4:8 gate helps us to cleave to Christ and His ways. Paul says this in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, lovely, whatever is admirable, excellent, or praiseworthy, think about these things. We need to cleave to Christ, and in doing so, we put up the 4:8 gate that says, hey, if it's not one of these things, it doesn't come through. Because we are fully committed and fully surrendered and fully focused on Christ and His eternal ways. Colossians 1, you won't have to turn there with me, Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. It says, since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. It's a reminder that we are fully committed. We have died to the old ways. We now live in Christ and we are focused on Him and His ways. 1996, John's Kinos delivered the keynote address at the National Baseball Coaches Convention. At that time, he was 78, 5 years removed from a distinguished coaching career of 40 plus years. He spoke for about 30 minutes with a home plate hung around his neck before he ever addressed it. But finally, he asked the question, do you know how wide the Little League home plate is? Even among the coaches, they just weren't quite sure, and so they answered with a little hesitancy, and one finally said, 17 inches? Yes. You know how wide the plate is for the high schoolers? 17 inches. Minor league baseball? 17 inches. For the big boys, major leagues? What happens when the pitcher can't throw the ball down those 17 inches? Move it to the outfield box. We encourage, we teach, we assist, we train, we challenge, we discipline. Throw the ball in between those 17 inches. One thing we don't do is widen the plate. Little leaguers, if you can't make it to be 17. We'll get a plate that's 18 inches wide. We'll get a plate that's 19 inches wide. No. No plate's a standard. 17 inches. You don't widen your plate. You hold them to the standard. You hold them to the expectation. 17 inches. We don't come to Jesus as King of Kings and Lord of Lords and tell him that, man, life following you is just too hard. Following you is just too difficult. Can we widen the plate? Can we make it a little easier? I've got some other things that I want to invest in. I've got some other things that are outside of your realm and of your ways and your truth. I want to do those things. Can we do that? Can we widen the plate to include those? Jesus very lovingly says to us, the widen the plate. The bar is set. The standard, the expectation is there. My followers are committed, surrendered, and focused. Their priority of life with me is first and foremost. The plate's not changed. It's not widened. The standard is set. And so we encourage and assist and teach and challenge each other to be committed, surrendered, and focused. Because that's what Jesus called his disciples to be. Disciples, you don't widen. We work hard and encourage and challenge ourselves to meet the bar, the expectation. Knowing only by the power of God can we achieve any amount of success in doing so, but we hold the standard. We hold the bar. Men, your church, your family, your nation, your world needs you to step up and step out. They need you to step up in the responsibility of being a godly man, a godly husband, a godly father. They need us to step out and be spiritual leaders in our homes and in our businesses and in our community. We don't need to widen the plate on what it means to be a godly man, a godly husband, a godly father. We need to be the standard. A study done in the Netherlands a few years ago found that the single greatest factor for children of Christian homes continuing in the faith, there were many factors, but the single greatest factor was the faithfulness of the Father. The Father lived out his faith. It was the greatest influence on those children when they were living out the faith. Had an impact as the mother did? Absolutely. Had an impact as others did? Absolutely. But maybe God's calling us to step up and step out. We're not widening the plate. We're working hard to meet the standard. Same for all of us as believers. In everything we do, we stay committed and surrendered and focused because that's what Christ asked of us. Our discipleship study is called Start to Follow. Today we commit fresh and again to start that we may follow Him wherever He leads, wherever He ends. And when the King calls,